Hello, welcome to Capcom Vancouver. My name is Jeffery Simpson. I'm the community manager here, and I work on the Dead Rising franchise as well. Today, something special. I'm here with Capcom Vancouver's two recruiters, Tracey and Kevin, and we're going to talk to them. We've been taking questions from the community about how to break into the game industry, different types of jobs, and how to basically start working, making games. So they're going to help me out with these questions. And we're going to hopefully give you guys some insight into how to make it into the industry. Let's start with you, Tracey. Can
sure.
you tell us a little bit about your industry experience and what you do here?
Yeah, I've been at Capcom Vancouver since 2011. And my first dabbling in video games was as an agency recruiter for Blue Castle. And when they got purchased by Capcom, I came on board as an in-house recruiter. And I've been here ever since.
Okay, and Kevin, how about yourself?
Yeah, I started my video game career in 2010, recruited at Electronic Arts Canada. Mm-hmm. After that, worked at Relic, which is a Sega studio, and have been here at Capcom for about 2.5 years. Love it, and really excited about staffing up some of the new stuff that we have going on in the future.
Excellent, so you've both been here for a while, and you work both with experienced candidates and you also do events like at the Film Institute of Vancouver, VFS, and other places. So you're used to working with all levels of candidates. Most of the questions we'll have today are from less experienced candidates. And these were solicited from a couple of our social media feeds as well as the Capcom Unity blog. So I've kind of collected kind of the major questions. And we're going to hit a few of them.
Great.
Let's start with this one. My question would be, what is the biggest option to overcome lack of experience to get into the industry? In my case, I would like to get into it as a rigger, but I often find the requisite of having 2 to 3 years of experience, if not more. So let's kind of go with a rigger first, if you can, and then kind of expand that basically to how someone without specific industry experience can kind of build that up.
Mm-hmm. Kev, do you want to take that?
Yeah, actually, I'd probably like to start with just making it a little bit more all-encompassing, how to get experience when you don't have any.
Right.
It's a really big challenge, and everybody who's ever worked in the industry has faced it at one point in their lives. What I like to tell people is really try to find that experience. There are great opportunities to volunteer in the video game community. It's huge. Either participate in hackathons, volunteer at hackathons, go to game jams, go to meetups, network, all of that can really, really help bolster your resume. I can honestly say that I've hired a number of interns and a number of co-ops here at Capcom as well as other video game studios. And I have definitely found each one of them at a game jam or talk to them at a networking event. It's a really great way to network and kind of build up some of your skills that way and get some professional experience. Just kind of working on a fun game at a game jam or hackathon.
Mm-hmm.
Sure. That probably then ties into the next question, which is, if there are no open positions, is it still a good idea to apply for an internship in a position we're looking for?
Not necessarily, right? Most of our time is going to be spent recruiting for jobs that are currently open for obvious reasons. I think that establishing a relationship with the recruiter, say on LinkedIn and social media, and keeping in touch with someone that way is probably more advisable, so that when something does open up, you might be the person that the recruiter thinks of because they have that relationship with you.
Mm-hmm.
All right. So does experience in other industries help? For example, the person asking the question has marketing experience, but not specifically video game marketing experience.
For me, I think it really depends on the role. Here at Capcom, we really like to hire craft specialists, people who really just want to take their craft to the highest levels. So we really like dedication and focus to discipline when we see applications, when we see resumes. But we do have a number of really cool stories here at Capcom, really diverse backgrounds.
Mm-hmm.
One of our senior designers, senior producers, used to be an accountant. We've had a number of senior designers here grow all the way up from QA, And even our studio director was once a radio personality DJ, and now he's running an entire game studio. So, yeah, it really depends on the role. But again, just going back to what we look for, I think at Capcom, really looking at craft specialists to really take their craft to the highest levels.
You know, and something you can do to overcome that is write your own story for what would it be. So if you were a marketing person, what about tailoring your cover letter to show how you might go about marketing a product that we're developing here at our studio and tell us what if?
Yeah.
That might be interesting to somebody who's looking for a junior entry-level role. You've got marketing chops, but not necessarily in video games, but you can tell a great story about why you would fit, why you love video games, what you think you would do in that role, and that can sometimes overcome the lack of experience.
All right. This is kind of maybe a bit general, but is there a kind of an age range you see people getting into the industry for their first job?
Most of our people are university grads, so early to late 20s is probably fair for the engineering side, entry level. Art, a little older possibly, and I would say design, again, on the younger, new grads for entry-level stuff. Median age in the studio is probably mid-30s.
Okay. Yeah, I think it's around 33 to 35 for our peeps.
So this is a game designer question. What are the most desirable and essential skills that a game designer would need to get into the industry today?
How to make games fun.
How to make games fun.
Yeah.
Totally.
Yeah. And how do they break that down? And how do they relay that idea? We are interested in people who have good paper design skills as well, all the way through ideas, can think it through. The been there, done that thing is great, again, because you can sort of say what pitfalls you might fall into and problems that might arise and things that you might avoid. But on the new rookie side, we're looking for people who just have awesome ideas and who have a lot of passion around what they want to do.
Yeah, for sure. And I would say more specifically to Capcom, we are developing games both in Unreal Engine as well as Unity. So if you're creating a portfolio, show us that you're playing around with these engines, building levels, show us some design docs that you've created, all of that really helps.
Yeah, the breakdown is important so that we can see what you understand beyond the idea.
Okay. What are the ideal or standard expectations for someone's portfolio or resume today? And maybe in that, some common mistakes you might see.
Do you mind if I take that, Kev?
Sure, totally.
Across the board for design, art, and engineers to some extent, too, I think that having a lot of links to Vimeo or YouTube to show your work there is great. One of the things that we see that's a bit of a problem is links on from a resume that are broken.
Exactly. Yeah.
You can't actually get in without a password. Yeah. Things to hinder you from seeing the person's work obviously are a mistake. But keeping that up to date, and then also sharing the stuff with Capcom that seems relevant, stuff that's going to be similar to the kind of products that we're making, and again, showing us why are you good for us, like what are you bringing to the table. All experience is good experience, but the more specific you can be to what we're looking for and what we do, the better.
All right.
I did want to talk to some pet peeves. Yeah, totally. Make sure all of your links work. We go through all of them. And it really is a detriment if some of your links don't work. And another thing that I sometimes see on portfolios that I personally don't like are pages that say under construction or coming soon. Yeah. When you present something to us, we want to see something complete. So a page like that isn't really helping you. Try to get your portfolio as complete as possible. And if it's a page where you're still kind of working on stuff, you can show us our progress. We want to see some of that stuff too.
And good advice is to have it be the best stuff. It doesn't necessarily have to be a huge load of work. It's just what we want to see, the best stuff that you have. So less is more for sure in that regard.
All right. This is more of a, this is a junior programmer asking this. So they're passionate about getting into gameplay programming. Specifically, they kind of signal AI programming. We've gone over, they had a question about portfolio. We've kind of covered that up. What am I going to ask here? What other skills besides kind of raw programming or to complement programming should they be looking for? The question asker specifically calls out VFX skills, understanding level design, and how to make that challenge to a player and creating environments. But is there any skills that are good to kind of craft on to or glom on to a programming background?
Animation in general is always handy. Mm-hmm. On the AI side, I think I would say 3D math and physics are things that we would like to see that you have good chops in. So that might mean showing us something where you can highlight that area mm-hmm. of the work that you've done. I don't think I can think of.
Yeah, I mean, we have a number of programming disciplines here. Rendering, animation, gameplay, AI, systems, UI.
Yeah.
As a junior a programmer or somebody just kind of getting into games from the very beginning, we don't expect you to be a specialist in any of these areas so far. We like to see a passion in a certain area, and we'll kind of just develop from there. At the very basics, Tracey, you already mentioned it, yeah, good math, 3D math, linear algebra, things like that. We're going to be interviewing you and testing you on those things in the interview, doing some solid problem solving on whiteboards, things like that. So just kind of depending on the type of position that you're going for in the different game team here, making sure that your C++ skills mm-hmm. are up to date, your C# skills are up to date. Just kind of work on those skills and just kind of maybe do some online tests, mm-hmm. tutorials and things like that, just to keep your skills
and
kind of relevant.
Reach back into your mm-hmm. education,
totally.
What you've done there, because that shows us that you have the good under the hood understanding of what you're doing versus the high level coding. You know, we want to know that you understand why you're coding in a particular manner and what it means to others who might come across that in other disciplines too. So you'll get questions around that, and just knowing what to code isn't enough. It's the why part.
All right, so here's a question about writers, and kind of to call out, we've had Jeffrey Campbell, the lead writer of Dead Rising 4, on a couple streams previously talking about the game and kind of his role writing it, and he's gone over his own career and how he got into the industry there. If someone wants to write for video games, how do they get started? How do they get in? Since it's not as technical, they don't have a list of, like, you need to know these languages sort of thing.
Being a gamer is a huge mm-hmm, part of it,
totally.
Because writing for a video game is so different than writing for a show or a book or, you know, a comic, or those things all help for sure. But understanding what goes into making a level and making a game fun again, that mm-hmm. part of it definitely has a large part in how you write.
Yeah.
The quality of writing, that's going to be something personal that you're bringing to it. But being a big gamer and understanding what makes a game fun and interesting to play and why do you want to keep moving forward, is probably the secret sauce mm-hmm. of a good writer in games.
Yeah, and I'm just trying to think back to when we hired Jeff and hired some writers on our team. Definitely having writing samples is really great. I think one application that I remember that really stood out, somebody wrote just dialogue in a script for a level that they made up in our game. Mm. I know a lot of our guys are really excited about that. So. Having writing samples being prepared to do a writing sample for us as well.
Yeah.
All right. This one we haven't had much experience with hiring it for a while because we've got Alexa, but if you're looking to create video game soundtracks, what skills do they need to get in?
Well, we just actually hired an audio intern for the first mm-hmm. time here at the studio. Really great to bring in kind of new energy, young energy to the team. They're already a fun bunch. I know that we were looking for people with some experience with Pro Tools, FMOD. The candidate that we ultimately ended up hiring had some experience in Unreal Engine already.
Mm-hmm. And I understand some programming libraries exactly. and porting and all that kind of
yeah.
stuff.
All right. Mm-hmm. So this one is from a game design master's student in Vancouver, actually, graduating in August. What skill set does the industry expect from a game designer? And I think they probably would have covered a little bit of this in their courses, but anything you would add that we'd be looking for?
Well, that's kind of a broad question. In terms of design chops, it really is a little bit dependent on the studio itself. So first off, just know the type of game that you want to make. If you're really big on mobile games, platformers, things like that, tailor your skills and kind of build your own personal games in that realm. If you really want to get into the big budget stuff, AAA games like we make here at Capcom, really kind of showcasing your skills in Unreal Engine. We really love that stuff, and just kind of going back to some of the stuff we discussed earlier. Just showing some stuff that you're tinkering around with, make a level.
Being a specialist too is probably yeah. advisable. You know, like if you want to be a weapons designer, or you want to be gameplay or level or a technical designer. I mean, there's a lot of offshoots just from design too, and picking one and really hammering down on that when you're trying to showcase your skills, the area that you're best in, is certainly advisable.
Okay, we've got a couple. I'm gonna kind of try and smush them down into one question. Because they both kind of relate to a university degree in programming versus learning it on the internet or kind of real life diploma / experience.
Yeah.
How, when you guys are looking at resumes, how big is a 4-year computer science degree versus I've done this in real life?
Huge.
Okay.
Yeah. And our engineers, almost everybody here has a 4-year degree, if not a master's. And they really value the deep down, low level learnings that they've had at school. They yeah. feel it makes them a really conscientious coder, somebody who really writes for legacy and, again, understands that what they're doing affects so many others that yeah. are going to be working with it. Not to say that we wouldn't consider somebody who is self-taught. We have in the past, and I'm pretty sure somebody has worked here at one time who did not have a computer science degree, mm-hmm. but came from a college where they had some technical learnings and that kind
yeah.
of thing, and they did really well, and they've gone on to a good career at another studio. I know that. So it's not to say it can't happen.
Right.
It's just not the huge.
Right.
I think a part of that is because of who we have in charge here to some mm-hmm. extent. Our technical directors all have those degrees, and they know the value to themselves, why
yeah.
they're looking for it. And so, you know, we do look for that first and foremost, but it's not an absolute, but it's pretty high.
Mm-hmm. All right. Here's a localization one. The question asker, I'm currently studying Japanese with the goal of getting into game localization. Mm. Are there any recommendations you folks have for getting into that field? What sort of other skills would make me a more attractive applicant? And Japanese, especially for us, is a big one because mm-hmm. we're Capcom. We're owned by a Japanese company, Capcom, and so we have quite a bit of dealings with Japan. But can you kind of expand on what you'd be looking for?
Yeah, I mean, a lot of that is outsourced at our studio. A lot of companies do the localization piece for all of the big countries that we would send our game to. So it's done out of one place. We have had in-house people for localization, but it hasn't been a massive role here at our studio. Mm-hmm. I could see it being in some studios a really big role. Mm-hmm. But for us, it's not something huge out of Capcom Vancouver.
Yeah. And there are companies that do that. So you'd be kind of best looking at applying at one of those places and getting in there.
Yes.
Because they kind of do them as what they call EFIG. So it's the European language, English, German, French, Italian, Spanish.
Yeah.
And then Russian, and then Japanese and some Asian languages are usually the big ones.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
But if you're actually, I would think, trying to get into the industry there as well, there is kind of a big QA development support aspect to localization as well. So look into that as well if you're kind of just trying to get into the industry and trying to go with that localization stream.
Mm-hmm. I'm trying to find where I am. Here we go. So this is an animator concept artist type job. And these jobs are harder because, again, they're soft skills as opposed to kind of hard checklisty skills. Mm-hmm. But what are the prerequisites for those sort of jobs? I mean, what do you look for in a portfolio for concept artists, character designer, background artists, those kind of those kind of roles?
So those are all very, I would say, different disciplines.
Right.
So I would say each one kind of has their own skill sets to them. So if I'm speaking more broadly, it really is trying to tailor your portfolio to the studio itself. Speaking to Capcom specifically, more in terms of our AAA console games, I mean, we deal with photorealism, so we really want to see how realistic you can make your game art. And also, again, as I mentioned earlier, tailor it to our studio. We don't do a lot of kind of like cartoony stuff. Kind of sci-fi things. So if you do have some of that stuff in your portfolio, I mean, it could look really great. But we want to actually see if we can see some of your art in our own games.
Mm-hmm.
So it's kind of a good mindset to put yourself into. Can my art in my portfolio be put in some of the games that Capcom is making?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and I had once heard one of our senior artists when we were at, I think we were at GDC, and he was reviewing a portfolio, and the advice that he was giving the young person that I've passed on myself is, you know, while a space creature, for example, is exciting and fun to look at, it goes back to that photorealism. There's nothing to base it on, so you can't say, yes, that's an excellent version of,
right,
because how would anybody know?
Right.
We haven't seen that. So vehicles, buildings, weapons, things of that nature,
mm-hmm.
you can absolutely say, yes, that looks exactly like whatever it is that you're trying
yeah.
to, and your talent can be measured against that. A lot of our artists will do our characters and send them in to us, and that's a really smart way of
mm-hmm.
putting your spin on something that's already there and showing us what your potential is.
Yeah, so I mean, I think, and I've heard this too, like, you know, if you're applying here, do, you know, our characters Frank West, do zombies,
mm-hmm,
maybe.
Mm-hmm.
Just like if you were applying at Marvel, you'd want to send in Spider-Man
sure.
and Iron Man and things like
yep.
that. So here we've got, we haven't really actually touched much on production, but how do you take, actually this isn't a production question, they just used the word. This is a freelance photographer and filmmaker. How do they take those skills, kind of doing things like that, and kind of making that into a career here? Is there kind of a translation that that can happen? I've worded that very vague.
For a photographer?
For a photographer / filmmaker.
Yeah, to some extent. We've just hired this year our first cinematic director, which is super exciting because, again, that's something that we've always outsourced.
Yeah.
But to the credit of our studio leadership, we're really growing, and we're able to have that in-house now. So
yeah.
That's fantastic. And I could see that eventually that would be something that would grow here at our
mm-hmm.
studio as well, with that whole area. Right now, it's not.
Yeah.
But, you know, there's, at like Electronic Arts, they have an entire studio within the studio dedicated mm-hmm. to that area for video games. And, you know, that would certainly be a place that I would apply if I was trying to get in that area.
Yeah, and we've had some contract in-house employees as well doing some video editing for mm-hmm. Like sizzle reels for our games and a little bit of that marketing stuff. So we do hire for those types of skills from time to time, for sure.
For kind contract of, stuff.
Yeah, video editors. Yeah.
So this next question, we've kind of touched on. It's a lot of, you know, I don't have the experience. I'm in school. I'm about to graduate. How do I get the experience? But one thing they do mention, which I think is a good thing to talk about a bit, is QA. A lot of people who want to be game designers kind of apply as mm-hmm. QA first to get that exposure to the industry and kind of build up relationships with people and kind of get to, you know, rub mm-hmm. shoulders with and get exposed to that mm-hmm. process. So can you talk a bit about QA as an entry point for other stuff?
It's great. We really value our QA team for sure, and I think we are actually endeavoring to make it a place where you can grow your career, period, mm-hmm. as somebody in QA. You know, it doesn't have to be the launch pad for another area at all. We are working on that as we speak. But yeah, it's a great entry point for people who want to do producer work or design work for sure. We've had people come in through QA who did video editing and a number of other roles too. So it's a great launch pad for a lot of roles. And we're looking for somebody who can be pretty technically savvy too most times in QA. It's probably a lot more technical than people think it is.
Mm-hmm. So this one, I'm going to try and answer it myself, but if you guys have a view, hop in on it. It's about a position for official retail rep for Capcom. Mm-hmm. It's a job that some companies, they call out Nintendo and Microsoft specifically, also Sony have. At least in North America, we don't have one. And that's someone who would go into a store like a Target or a Walmart
right.
and look at the displays and stuff like that. I think the three you call out in the question are all console makers, so that aspect is a bit more important to them.
Yeah.
Because they want to have a display with their console there and everything.
Right.
Whereas we'll have relationships with the stores directly, where we don't necessarily have to have someone physically going into all the stores.
Yeah. And for DR4 and DR3, we partnered with Microsoft.
Yeah.
And so in large part, they took that role on. But out of Capcom USA in San Francisco, that's where our marketing arm would be.
Right.
And where those roles like that generally sit.
Yeah. And previously, places I've worked, THQ, for example, EA, they don't even have those roles because it's something they trust the retailers mm-hmm. to handle. And again, if you have a box that you need to display in a certain way, it's a bit different. We just don't have a role like that currently.
That'd be fun, though.
Yeah. It would be, yeah. I've, in previous jobs, in a previous industry, that I've worked with those type of people, and it's a pretty, mm-hmm. pretty good job. So this one I will also take. It's the last question, but it is about community management. But actually, I'll throw it to you first. What do you look for when hiring the right candidate? What do you look for in finding the right candidate when it comes to social media or community management, besides the love for gaming?
I would say interviewing skills, for sure.
Yeah. Yeah.
Photogenic.
Yeah.
Yes. Handsome. Always helps.
I think we got that covered already. Yeah.
I think somebody who has really good market understanding, for sure. So, yes, being a lover of games, but also being a lover for marketing and for how to talk to people and your community at large and understanding sort of the psychological side of why people play our games and why they buy our games and what they want to talk about, are really really savvy understanding of when to post, how to post, who to post to.
Yeah, and I would say definitely a love for the game that they're like a social media-ing about. I've worked with different social media peeps over my career and can really see the benefit of somebody who's actually played the game and is able to speak to their experiences playing the game, as opposed to somebody just kind of just taking more of that high-level marketing approach to it. So somebody, again, who's really passionate about the game that we're making and can really speak to it and plays it.
What I would recommend, this isn't going to necessarily get you hired, but you have to be patient, you have to be understanding in terms of actually doing the job well. One thing that you see a lot is the people in communities often will get hired to work on games. This happened, for example, Tomb Raider, a cosplayer was hired to be their community manager. So it's, you know, being engaged in communities of the games you love is a real foot in the door, because when the dev team starts looking, okay, we need someone to handle this, they can say, hey, this person is already engaged, they're already showing they know the game, and that they're being, you know, they're really, you know, on Facebook, they're on Twitter, they're posting a bunch about it, which then leads to the point that, you know, the Whedon's law, which is don't be a dick. if you love a game and you spend your whole time slamming it, that's probably not the best foot in the door.
No.
But definitely being engaged in video game communities helps. And for my first role, it was not a game that I was previously engaged with, but I had kind of this background where I could point out, like, well, I've run this fan site for this other game. I've written, you know, these blog posts here I can send you about games. So I could show that I'd, you know, could write about games, that I knew what was going on in the industry. So kind of last, we're out of set questions. I've kind of condensed them all. Maybe one each on advice you'd give to people starting out that we haven't really covered yet.
Yeah, having an excellent resume. And that means keeping it clean. I don't have a rule if it has to be one page or more or whatever. It's whatever it takes to get all your stuff on the resume. But keeping it clean, easy to read, all of your contact details being up to date, all your links being up to date, personalizing your URL on LinkedIn is always handy, and having that on your resume so that we can put a face to the name, and having your experience as accurate as possible on your resume, showing a little more than just your job title and how long you worked somewhere, a little bit of a breakdown of what you actually owned in that particular role, and maybe something that you're really proud of that you did at that job.
I think for one thing that we do really like to see is that you've actually played our game, or at the very least looked it up on YouTube and watched the playthrough. You're going to get asked about it if you do get interviewed here at Capcom, so be prepared for that.
Especially in design.
Especially in design, yeah. So we really love to hire people that are passionate about our games and have played our games before in the past.
Yeah. Well, thank you, everyone who's watched this. Hopefully we've answered your questions. We may do this again later if we get a bunch of more questions. But thank you for tuning in, and have a good day.
Thank you.
Thank you.